Without the shedding of blood, says the writer, the epistle to the Hebrews, there is no remission of sin. The sacrifices of the old order prefigured Calvary and drew any merit they had from it by anticipation. But this is Yom Kippur par excellence. The Lamb himself carries away the sins of the world. The Father kept him alive despite the fact that he was, humanly speaking, completely exhausted, drained, and a dead man walking on the way to Calvary. He kept him alive when they could have lynched him, stoned him earlier on, for he had to die on a cross. It was the chosen means. And the cross is the sign of the Son of Man that will be seen in the heavens on the last day. The devil, of course, knows the power of the crucifix. He does not like it around. He knows also the power of the precious blood. One drop of this precious blood could save all humanity. But all the blood was drained. He gave himself totally. To this day, pilgrims can see the precious blood on Mount Calvary. It has been venerated, observed, visited throughout the centuries by Christian pilgrims. And there, on Mount Calvary, they have deliberately exposed it behind glass. The same is true of the split in the rock which happened at the moment of death, the earthquake. All that is to be seen under glass. I was talking recently to the one who had been responsible for the main relic of the cross in Rome as a Cistercian, and who allowed me to have a small splinter of it, and quoted what had happened some years ago when Monsignor Dansk, a bishop and an exorcist, was having trouble to cast out demons in one soul, and in the end said, "I will, in that case, go and get the relic of the Holy Cross." He meant the big one. And immediately the demon screamed and howled. "No, not that one. It still has his blood upon it." This is here behind me in this little tabernacle, and therefore Calvary is here. That precious blood is still pleading for humanity, able to heal mind, soul, and body. And many are touched by that healing. One small drop of this precious blood cried out Faust in the drama would be enough, for he had sold his soul to the demon, and the demon was coming for that soul at death. Death is a time when one small drop of that blood really counts. What would they not do in the trenches to have a priest? And the priests sometimes were kept alive miraculously because they were so precious. Many priests in France had to also be soldiers. That was the case at that time. It was not long after the power of the Freemasons had done much damage in France. And so there was I in the midst, in the hall of a great railway terminus in Paris. A number of wounded were laid out on the straw, waiting to be taken to a hospital. Eight of them were very badly hurt, and some of them were evidently not long for this world. One of them seemed to be very uneasy. A nurse went up to him and offered to rearrange his bandages. "I want a confessor very badly," was his reply. "Is there a priest here?" asked the nurse. Just then, another soldier, lying mortally wounded, plucked the nurse by the sleeve. "Madame, I am a priest. I could give him absolution. Carry me to him." The nurse hesitated. The soldier was suffering from the effects of a horrible shell wound, and the least movement gave him excruciating pain. But again, the feeble voice quietly said, "You are of the faith, and you know the price of a soul. What is one more hour of life compared with that?" And the soldier raised himself by a supreme effort to go to the side of his comrade. But the effort was in vain. He had to be carried. The confession did not last long, and the strength of the soldier priest was ebbing rapidly away. When the time came to give the absolution, he made a sign to the nurse. "Help me to give the sign." The nurse held up his arm while this was being done. Death followed quickly for the soldier priest and his penitent. They died hand in hand while the nurse and the ambulance men fell on their knees, each side of them. But sometimes a priest could not be got. The soul was alone before the unknown, suffering and ebbing out, crying out precisely for one small drop of the precious blood. This happened in the same great war. Sent with five men to reconnoiter in a wood, we came across an Uhlan officer with two men who were dismounted studying a map by the light of an electric lamp. We charged them with a bayonet. The two men were killed, the officer severely wounded. I went to him and found him a handsome figure of a man with a face like marble. Lying in a pool of his own blood, he murmured words of which, though I could not understand at first, I gradually gathered the meaning. He said that he was a Pole and a Catholic, and tried to pull from his pocket his rosary and an image of Our Lady and the infant Jesus. At this sight, all my fury died down, and having placed my men at their posts, I went back to him and made him understood that I too was a Catholic, and my greatest desire was to comfort him in these his last moments. He seemed to understand and lifted up his rosary Seeing what he wanted, I decided to take aid, and he answered feebly and more feebly in German, after which he raised the beads to his lips and kissed them several times. Then he handed them to me, and I also kissed them. This seemed to please him. Then I had to go back to my men. So I put his rosary and image in his hands and left him. Next morning, on my way back to the trenches, I found him lying dead, just as I had left him. Some time ago, I received an unexpected message from the other end of Ireland. There was a fairly young lady dying, but who had somehow not been accepting the situation very well, and the family were concerned. They wanted somebody to try to talk to her and prepare her for what was going to be inevitable death, cancer. So I went, and at that time she was not able to speak anymore, but she was lucid, and I was able to somehow communicate the fact that Jesus was on side and waiting for her, to ask her whether she wanted absolution. All she could do was nod her head, but the essential was sufficient to give a grace-filled application of the precious blood. And just a few hours later, I discovered that she, who had refused morphine, being a nurse herself and wanting to be lucid as long as possible, and just afterwards accepted morphine. And a few hours, her eyes were closed and her soul washed in that precious blood. With Jesus. In the confession box, one is doing the same all the time. In Italy, we still have the old confession boxes, quite often still use them. Centuries old sometimes. One day I was cleaning the old confession box, which had heard so many sins over the centuries. In that, the precious blood is applied to soul after soul. Soul after soul goes away, washed by the touch of that same blood that comes through the priest. For at the point of saying, "I absolve," his voice box is used by the high priest himself, the Lamb of God, who uses him to be him here on earth. How many times have I seen the power of this blood? It's so important to get a complete confession, and many souls do not make a complete confession, favoured by what is in the air. It's enough to make just a general statement of sorrow. It's not, how can one be absolved from what one actually hides? Each grave sin must be confessed. And all this receiving of the precious blood in the host, for it is there always by concomitance, without being washed in the precious blood in confession, is not helping the church. One cannot celebrate Easter without passing through the precious blood on Calvary. And so this is the day, Yom Kippur par excellence, in which the precious blood was gently and without shortcuts touch soul after soul, calmly and quietly, giving each enough time to unburden himself. Psychologically also it heals. Nothing could replace a good confession. The old confessional. how many sins have crossed this little grill that stands aloft alone between heaven and hell? How oft was blood that on this cross lies still shed on a gaping chasm, ere a knell o'er blasted aeons rang? How oft did he through these weak pores soft pass and cancel all that could the demon's saint in damned glee? At what was not revoked in moments small? Great elegance is not in this wee box that holds the skies at large, yet charged is this, each splinter and each crack, and all hell rocks with irritation strong at swindled bliss that had no right to be, that should not be, for such dry rot dries not.